Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Fiction Silicon Valley Spotlight. This is the second one under the Fiction Silicon Valley name. I used to do a lot of these under another name, Old Dog New Tricks, which is the gaming channel that I did with my son. So now I'm starting to roll these over as they come in under the new Fiction Silicon Valley banner so that it fits a lot more with the books that we're doing in the spotlights. So today we have John Howell, who we've had him before. We last talked to him in November 2015, and we're very excited because he's back now with his complete trilogy. So we have here My Girl, His Revenge, and the new book that just came out a couple months ago, Our Justice. And so now the trilogy is complete. Let's go ahead and switch on over to John and see how he's doing with that. Hello, John. Welcome again to FSV Spotlight.
Well, thanks, Steve. It's great to be here. And as you can see, I don't look too much older.
I know. I went and I watched the video just so I can make sure I can seem smart. And I watched the video. I'm like, oh my gosh, we both look the same.
We have the tape.
There we go. Just, you know, cucumbers on the eyes.
Right.
And everything. So welcome back.
Well, thank you.
The Spotlight, where we shine the spotlight on you and your books. And so tell us what you've been up to since we last talked.
Oh, my heavens. Last time I was here, I was planning to launch the last book of the trilogy, Our Justice. And I managed to do that. Thank you. In the meantime, I had a publisher for the original Our Girl. My Girl, I'm sorry. I've got Our Justice and My Girl in my head.
They get confused.
Yeah, the original book, which is the cover is quite different. We sort of came to an end of our contract. The contract was a 3-year agreement, and it ended. So what that did is put me at the opportunity kind of portal to go ahead and relaunch My Girl, which I just finished with a new cover. I actually had it re-edited because I was not happy with the editing that was done by the publisher. And as you all know, and everybody should know, when you're with a publisher, you do exactly as the publisher says, and not any more or any less.
Exactly. So, they hold a lot of the cards.
Yeah, most of the cards. Well, it was kind of strange because when I got the contract, I looked at it and I said, boy, this is the most egregious contract I've ever seen in my life. And it took me 2 seconds to sign it. You know, it was like, oh, well,
industry standard.
Yeah, firstborn. It's a standard agreement. 2 cents on royalties, you know, that kind of thing.
Exactly.
So I sense we both agreed that we would part ways. And so that allowed me to actually launch His Revenge and then Our Justice, and then allowed me to go back once the contract was done. Go back and relaunch My Girl, which I've done.
And then you also put a new cover on,
yes,
My Girl.
Exactly.
And since we're talking about that one first, before we get to your most recent ones here, let me bring that up. And you mentioned in your notes to me that you wanted to talk about some of the reasons why you picked the new cover you did.
Yes. If you notice, the cover depicts a military person. And in My Girl, the target of the terrorists is actually a group of military people. I wanted to have a female character, not necessarily because the book is called My Girl, but, you know, there is some logic there.
Right.
But also the idea that our military right now is a very diverse and kind of a broad-based organization made up of all volunteers, of course, and of across all members of society. So the girl is an Asian, she does represent that diversity aspect of the military. The backdrop showing a little bit of agitation in the sky sort of depicts the kind of trouble ahead.
The coming storm.
The coming storm, yes. Excellent way to put it, Steve. Also, you notice there's a little silhouette of a boat.
Right.
The boat is angled at a point of it's actually going down. So
It's a sinking ship.
Sinking ship.
And what? You start your thriller on the cover.
Yeah, and the first paragraph, I hope.
Oh yes, we talked about that last time. Where yes. I mean, just boom, out of the gate, big stuff happening. Which is, you know, like I said before, my love is thrillers, and you know, every story I've written, no matter what genre I've written in, at its heart, it's a thriller. Because that's just, I love those. I love all the movies. I love all the books. It's just, that's what I love. And so I loved how you start out right away. And I like the new cover.
Okay.
You know, the other cover was just, I think, just blue.
Well, it was blue. It was a stock, you know, it was a stock cover. And I couldn't talk the publisher out of it. and they had full charge of cover. They had full charge of creative, full charge of almost everything.
Exactly.
But I said, well, okay, let's just go with it. Because it did sort of kind of depict, you know, the very, very end of the book, where a character looks up and sees the sky.
Right.
A little bit of deep water, let's put it that way. So I was okay with it. But the current book looks more like the other two. And quite honestly, the artist is the same. So.
Oh, yeah, and that I always like that aspect of, you know, as now that you have your series out and you were able to relaunch with the new cover for the first one because you're able to bring that book back in from another publisher so that you had more control over it, you were able to get the same artist so that you have the same eye.
Yes. Yes.
For everything. And let me switch over real quick here. So here's now the three books, My Girl, His Revenge, and Our Justice. And so now they have a lot more cohesive look to them.
Right.
And
right.
They definitely scream thriller to me.
Yeah. While you have them up there, Steve, uh-huh. let me just say, His Revenge, you notice that the target on the character, that is out of a scene in the book where, a romantic interest of John Cannon, the hero, is actually targeted by the terrorists. So that,
oh man.
And that's a fairly good depiction of her. Her name is Stephanie, and it looks a lot like Stephanie.
Oh, excellent.
And then in Art Justice, I gave a little bit of a visual to let people know what John Cannon looks like.
Ah, okay. The good rugged hero.
Yeah, he's your everyday kind of guy, but he's been under stress here. He's not in his coat and tie.
This is now the third story with him, right?
Right, exactly.
So by his third story, he's no longer the button-up, expensive suit, San Francisco lawyer type. Now he's out there getting scruffier and seeing more of the world, the bad side of the world.
Yeah, he's been away from the law firm almost 4 months at this point, by the end of the story. And he's gone native, let's put it that way.
Native in a very side of the world we don't normally see.
Exactly. Yeah, it continues.
So continues. Tell us a little bit about John J. Cannon, your main character, which I notice he has the same name as you.
Gee. How does that happen?
Living vicariously through your fictional character, are we, John?
Well, my wife would say, John, you could have picked anything but John. And she's told me that several times. The reason I picked John is by the time I finished My Girl, the first draft, there wasn't another name because I'd use it as an operating name.
Ah.
You know, I just threw John down there to leave it there.
A placeholder, but then it became the character. Yeah.
I was searching for names, and no other name fit. The Cannon part worked, the J part worked, and John just seemed to roll from there. So I never did change it, and he and I have become fast friends over the last three books. In fact, I just finished an interview where John interviews me.
Oh.
Yeah, and he's asking me all kinds of penetrating questions.
Like, why did you do that to me?
He also wanted to know, how come you wouldn't let me shoot somebody?
Oh.
Yeah, and he kept wanting wanting to shoot somebody. So finally, sure, I let him shoot somebody, and he absolutely got sick. You know,
he didn't like it.
So that was the way to cure that problem. So, but the John just stuck in the story, and I couldn't get it out of the story. And so after I decided his name was John, it just flowed the rest of the trilogy.
Excellent. So tell us a little bit about, now that you've got the whole trilogy out there, yes, what was it like writing the same character? Do these books, are they back to back? Is there big gaps of time between them? How does the story play along for your trilogy?
Yeah, it was interesting, Steve. That's a great question, because I had originally thought the story would be a one book story. You know, I just went along. I started writing. I'm a panster. I plan very roughly, but I go along, and I find the characters, as characters develop, they tend to make the story move ahead. Well, the story became so fat, I call it fat, I couldn't conclude it in the first book. So there is no time gap between the books. They flow one after the other. What the second book is a continuum of the first, and then the third is a continuum of the second. Now, I had a problem, as you can imagine, as a writer, and you're an excellent writer. How do I accommodate someone who picks up book two and never read book one?
Right.
And that's a real problem, because people get very annoyed when they realize it's a second book, even though you put it in as tall letters this big, second book.
They don't see that.
No. So what I did is, trying to keep backstory to a minimum, what I did is I recast each story in a way so that the new reader, if they're a new reader, they wouldn't need to go back to book one. And book three, you can read without going back to book two, without a lot of repeat. In other words, I again go into the action at a point where someone's comfortable, that they understand who is who and what's going on.
Excellent. So you were able to layer in at the beginning some information so that even though it's a continuing series, you can pick up each one as a standalone. And that's good planning for a pantser on your part.
Yeah. Well, I finished, I actually had book three rough draft done about the same time as book one was published. So I had a bunch of time to get reader reaction. I had a bunch of time to,
right,
you know, before I launched book two. And it was very clear when asked, and people will ask you all the time, do I have to read book one? And you want to say, yes.
You should read them all. Come on.
Yeah, of course. Buy book one, please. But incidentally, I felt my, you know, I owe a reader something. They don't have to be chained to my series. They can they can come and go as they wish. By the way, book one was priced, I thought, very, very highly, because traditional publishers always publish books.
Right, they have the prices at a certain level.
Yeah. So I launched my girl at 99 cents, because I think that's an entry-level price that sustains the rest of the series. So.
Right, and it eliminates any, you know, a dollar is, you know, there's no resistance for a purchase at that point.
I call it a third of a cup of a Starbucks.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And it'll last you longer and be with you longer.
Yeah, yeah. At least we can go that far, you know.
Right, right. So you had finished your rough draft, and the last time we talked, you made mention that you're a pantser.
Yeah.
You do very minimal plotting. And one of the things that you mentioned that I want to come back to is you had a plan of no lunch until you hit 1,000 words in a day.
Yes.
Do you still starve yourself? Or have you in the groove now? Now you've gotten three books published.
Right.
I'm sure you're working on others. We'll get to that soon. But right. Do you still hold yourself to that no lunch till, you know, no eat until I've got my work done?
I've released on that. I do, however, hold myself to 1,000 words a day before I can do something that is other than writing. In other words, my family understands that honey-do lists and all that have to wait. And nicely in kind of these times, 1,000 words comes pretty fast. Didn't used to, but now it does.
Practice.
And again, this is in spite, and you know, I blog every day of the week, so I don't count those as my 1,000 words. I don't count Twitter work as 1,000 words or any social media work. It's all what my current work and process is.
Right, these are 1,000 words of new fiction.
New fiction on a novel.
Right.
Because I do write short stories. I could define that as new fiction, but that'd be cheating.
Yeah, you want to get progress on your novel.
Yes.
And I was, now that you've mentioned your blog and your writing, I went and I checked out your blog. I don't remember looking at that as much last time, but there's so much more on there now. You've got days where you, Wednesday hump day, you've got a short story hump day.
Right.
You've got things going on Tuesdays and Thursdays and Saturdays. Yep. You seem to have things going on all different days. Tell us a little bit about the blog that you've got going on there.
Yeah, I blog every day. And when I first started, I was doing a lot of, I don't know what you would call it, reblogging of other blogs and that kind of thing. And I just felt it was unfair to people not to have some original work and have it routinely, something they could count on. So I made a deal. I mean, I published my schedule. It's in the About section of my blog. Sundays is a view of my neighborhood. Mondays is a top 10 list that I have. And by the way, everybody, it's humorous. Don't keep writing me about how useful the top 10 list is. It really isn't. I make that stuff up.
Well, it's the top 10. I saw the one, the top thing, 10 things not to do in the back of a police car.
Not to do. The last one was not to do in the back of a police car. So you can imagine, you know, I mean, it's
how kinda humorous this is going to be.
Yeah, kind of ludicrous. Wednesday is hump day, and so it's also called story day. Thursday is a little personal. And what I've done is set a Thursday aside to be able to talk about a book or talk about some things that are going on. I also use that time to support other authors, have guest blogs and that kind of thing for other people. Friday is, of course, TGIF. So we have a little, I also do what is called a janku, which is a haiku. One of my readers said, you know, I don't know if you can call it haiku, but it certainly is janku. I just accepted that and called it janku. And then on Saturday, there's a lovely prompt, Stream of Consciousness Saturday, it's called Prompt, that is published by a young lady by the name of Linda Hill every week. And I've tied into that. And that is, again, a short story. And by the way, my short stories are all dialogue.
Oh, interesting.
100%. And with no tags. And why I do that is to practice dialogue with no tags so that people can understand what's going on when they read, and that I train myself to stay away from he said, she said, and all of that stuff.
Right.
And try to put action into the dialogue so that people understand what's going on. And not just cop out with, you know, he said while turning a page of a very big I find that to be, it slows everybody down and it isn't effective. So I try to keep running on dialogue, and I twice a week I do that, and I do it on purpose. A lot of people have questioned that. Gee, how do you know? You know, well, you have to read it. You know, you can't jump in and say, well, who said that? You have to read from the front, figure it out. So that's my blog. And I've been disciplined to it for the last 2 years, and it works very well. I don't do it for any other reason than I've got a bunch of followers who seem to enjoy it, And I just love to read their comments. I love the whole process. And I don't even know if it sells a book or not. I don't hump my books there a lot. They're in the, what is it called? The margin. You can go to the
right,
margin.
Uh-huh. You see the margin, yeah. The books on the side. It's really mostly blog stuff that you have going on. But it gives you an opportunity to interact with other people out there.
And everything. There's a tremendous community of very supportive people that are called technically bloggers. Most are writers, and most are just willing to help anytime that you have a question, have a problem. Most of my beta readers came from my blogging efforts. I have Uncle Sam, you know, Uncle Sam needs you.
Right.
I have this graphic, and it, Uncle Sam needs you too. And then at the bottom is the descriptor. And then I get so many volunteers that it's just, it's miraculous.
That's great. And you mentioned that you put your email in your books.
Yes.
And everything, because you're trying to foster the, hey, contact an author. So do you have any guidelines or anything for people when they want to contact an author?
Yeah, it's interesting. In years ago, I had an experience. John Cheever was one of my favorite storytellers. I thought he did a marvelous job, and he published this huge volume of all his short stories. And I wrote him, and I wanted to find out, how do I write this guy? Well, I went to the publisher, and
there's no help there.
Well, I finally found out that most authors in those days they wanted to stay behind either an agent or a publisher.
Right.
I think today, with indie authors, I think most of us are willing to be accessible at any time.
Right out there, front and center.
Exactly. And if there's a question, if there's a comment, if there's a complaint, whatever it is, I make sure that I'm available. So I would say to anybody, first thing to do is go to a book. If an author really wants you to contact them, in the back of the book will be their email address. Failing that, there's probably a website. So you start there with a website or an email address. Then the other interesting thing is if you know your author's coming to a book signing in your area, go to the book signing. Take a book you've already bought, because it's kind of nice to have a little bit of a subject to talk about. You don't have to stand there and buy a new book. You could take an old one. Most authors are more than happy to sign any of their work. And actually, if you don't even have a book to sign, most authors are more than happy to talk to you right at the book signing. And then anytime an author is, you know, at a store or in an appearance, that's an opportunity as well. When we do have book signings, we try to publish them, so one has to kind of read about that. And then the last place to go is Amazon. Most of the authors are on Amazon, and most have a page, Amazon author page, and there's a place for comments. And you can actually leave a comment on an author's page. You can leave a comment actually on their book pages.
It is such a different world. I mean, I remember way back when reading books, I'd get them at the bookstore, I'd read it, and I go, that was great. And then that was that.
That was that.
There was no dialogue with an author. There was no contacting them. You know, again, you try to hunt down the publisher, but especially before any kind of internet days, there was just an address in New York you could write to, and that was it.
It reminds me of that record where the singer has gold records on the wall in an office. Leave me a message, maybe I'll get back to you.
Right.
It was kind of like that. You know, maybe you'd get a response. John Cheever did respond.
Oh, good.
Graciously. And it's a memento that I'll always cherish. But it took, it must have been 6 months.
For that turnaround.
Yeah.
Now it's instant.
Well, it's
which
instant.
Is good and bad.
Good and bad, exactly.
So you,
I think most of us want to hear the good and bad.
Yeah, exactly. We want an even tempering systems where we're, you know, we definitely don't want to hear all good, because then somebody's not telling us something. But then we don't want to hear all bad because, like, I can't possibly be that bad.
Well, I think some of us could be if we really tried.
But they know. They know they're that bad.
Yeah.
It hopefully isn't a surprise.
Yeah, I'm never surprised when, you know, it's really interesting when someone will nail me on an item. It generally is not a surprise because I had probably had that same concern when I wrote the item. A young person wrote John Cannon in the second book actually has a relationship with two women. And this young person was not very happy with John Cannon doing that. And I knew when I wrote it, and I had to write it that way because it was almost key to the following book. So what I did when I wrote back, I said, you know, if you'll go to the third book, you will find that the redemption and the absolute pain that John goes through as a result of doing that, you will find it very satisfying. So
there you go. So you were laying some groundwork for some very powerful redemption and character growth for
right.
The third one.
I had to build in a flaw, and then I had to make sure the flaw was resolved later. So.
And you know, when you did that, and now you know, because you got that response from a reader, you know, I picked the right flaw because it made an impact.
That's a good point, Steve. I hadn't thought of that. That's an excellent point.
You know, they always say, if you make someone upset, you know, if you never make anyone upset, you're not trying hard enough.
Good point. Yeah.
So that was the fact that you got that reader feedback, even though it was a negative feedback, it actually, I like to throw positive spins on everything. Yeah. It lets you know that you hit you hit something.
Right.
And that was a good one to hit.
Yeah. I think you're right. It's perfect.
So now that you've completed your trilogy, and I'm sure, you know, when the first one was out, the second one was out, and people are going, when's the next one? Then now they're all three out. You come to a resolution at the end of the third one?
Yes. The third one asks the question, who gets justice? And I do in the blurb, who gets justice? Matt Jacobs, who's the antagonist, John Cannon, and then I put in the little hook, or neither. You know, I mean, there's a possibility that there's absolutely no justice in this world. But I think the readers will understand that the way the story ended was the way it basically had to end.
So do you have any plans for more Cannon stories?
Not John Cannon himself. I am working right now. There's the Port Aransas police chief is a character named Ned Trains. And I've received a lot of feedback that people really like him.
One of the side characters in your stories?
Yeah, he basically accused John of, I mean, he was in the first book, looks at John as a person of interest.
Ah.
Because, you know, and the blurb will tell you, John's found unconscious on top of the gun that killed the young lady who's found dead next to him.
Right.
So, you know, this police chief, I mean, you don't let police
chiefs... Tied up with a bow. There it is.
Yeah. They don't go away too easily until it's proven. Well, he becomes very close to John and considers John, you know, a very close friend. And I've got a story started where the police chief is involved in an episode that a couple finds a phone on the beach. And the phone is one of these modern Motorola phones, and it doesn't have any kind of security system on it, so you can scroll through it. And the couple notices that there's a lot of Al-Qaeda, and a lot of kind of anti-American sentiments on the phone, a lot of pictures. So they figure they better take it to Homeland Security or the police chief. They go
right,
to
right.
And it was a good thing because what we don't know is the phone was a young man's phone, but his uncle had placed some encoded terrorist plans on it. In other words, it was a very innocent thing to do. And right. should the phone fall into anybody's hands, very difficult for anybody to know it was there. Well, this kid got drunk and lost the phone, basically on the bridge. So there you are. So Ned Trains, the police chief, will be right in the middle of that story. And so we have to first find out, will the uncle trace the phone, find it? Because he desperately needs the phone.
Right.
What will happen to this young man? I mean, not a big deal, but, and, you know, what is this plan going to lead us to? So working on that. So that is a kind of an offshoot of John Cannon. I don't think John will do anything in the story other than come in for a drink, maybe.
Right. He'll make an appearance just to keep it all in the same universe.
Yeah, because he's right now, John's a charter captain in Port Aransas. He wanted to do that. That's what he's doing. And so I can't imagine that good friends don't meet now and then. So that's right. Probably where it'll end up. But the main story will be Ned Trains.
Excellent. And then you also mentioned last time when we met, you had a book that you were also working on called Circumstances of Childhood.
Yes.
How is the status on that?
Well, when we last talked, I had finished the draft. And what I did with the draft, because it's a very, it's an unsettling story to me, personally, because it has some elements of autobiographical nature. And I wanted to make sure that I wasn't just all and wrapped up in my own underwear, and wanted to make sure it was a story that people would enjoy.
Right.
So I had 10 people willing to read it.
That's a good number.
Yeah, I was quite surprised. In fact, I had to limit the list because I felt that any more than that, I probably wouldn't be able to.
Everybody react. Wanted to get their hands on the next John Howell thriller.
I guess. But I wanted to make sure that I could read the feedback correctly, you know. And I said, you know, if you get 10 people giving you feedback, you've got to be able to read it so that you're not running in 10 different directions.
Right. You got to look for the commonality among it.
Yeah, the feedback was all very consistent. In other words, the story, they liked the story. There were a couple of disturbing elements in the story that were not character typical. In other words, what I had done is I'd taken the character and moved them out of what they normally would do. And that a writer should never do, because you're just, you know, you're asking for trouble. And these
folks, well, you're creating conflict as well.
Yeah. So I had to do a rewrite, which I did. Then I tested it again, and I'm at this very moment in the final throes. So the book, I think, will be published in September.
Oh, very nice.
Yes, I'm looking at a September view. And it's a story of two very close friends. Both of them want to be NFL football players. They both, really go at it in a big way. One of them makes it, and one of them doesn't. And again, you can't take the thriller writer out of the writer. I wanted to make a different kind of story, but it does end up that one of the characters gets into a tremendous amount of trouble. And the question of this book is, will the other guy who didn't make it as an NFL player want to help out?
Uh-huh.
So that's what we have to look forward to.
That internal struggle of, he took my spot in the NFL. If he wasn't around, I would have been number one.
Yes. Yeah, in fact, the guy that goes to the NFL becomes a big maven on Wall Street. So Yeah, there's a lot of envy to go around. Let's put it that way.
Excellent. So what is next for you?
Well, I'm having to wrap up this Ned Train story that I told you about. And that's going to take me, my problem is I'm not very good at multitasking when it comes to writing. I become a little bit linear. I had to kind of drop circumstances of childhood to finish the My Girl relaunch. You know, Yeah. So now back to circumstances of childhood, and I'm dropping some semblance of putting final touches on the Ned Train story. So that one is going to have a little bit of a hiatus point. So my next story, I have to be honest with you, Steve, I haven't thought of the next one yet.
And but this when is you the do, first... you'll write the end sentence first.
I do. And I don't have three sentences to put at the end. And I try to write the three openers and the three enders. And I have Ned Trains. I've got that one. But I don't have the next book. And it's kind of a concerning... you know, deep within me, when I have those 3 o'clock, I call them the 3 o'clock pig roast, which is, and I don't know if you've ever had this, where you kind of turn on a spit,
right?
That you're basting. My 3 o'clock time frame is spent. You got to get to that next book, because that's the only way you'll get it written.
Yeah. You got to start it, yep. And in your case, you got to write that end so that you have your finish line to run towards.
I do. And I hope the next time I come back, I can report that I did three lines and I've got it. Ned Trains is all done and all of that.
All right.
But right now, it's pretty tense.
So there's a thriller happening in your house, in your head.
Yes.
Going, I got to do it, but I don't know what to do.
I know. And my wife always goes, you know, I love this self-imposed tension. You know, the rest of the world's in turmoil.
Right.
In your lonely room, tense, because you don't have another book started. I mean, come on.
And that's the thing is you sit there and you write so much. You've done so much. You've done an entire trilogy. That's more than a lot of people. A lot of people write the first book. Sales don't happen. They go, why give up? And you didn't give up. You said, I'm writing the next book. I have a plan. I have a desire. What I want to do is I want to write.
Right.
And so you're doing that. And I sense and I know exactly how you're feeling right now when you're going, I'm not writing the next book. Ah!
Yeah.
Because you want to write. And, you know, that's the thing with me is, you know, I had a whole bunch of books that I wrote in a very short amount of time. And then I haven't put pen to paper in a while. And I'm getting all... Oh, the shaking's going down, actually, so I'm doing good.
How long, Steve? How long? Pen to paper, how long?
Oh, wow. It has been almost a year and a half now.
Oh.
So I'm getting ready to get back into it. I had to try to launch one thing, and then that didn't work out, and I'm launching something else that then enables me to try something new. And I'm always wanting to try something new. So yes. Now I'm going to try to do a choose your own adventure style story. And I have everything in place so that I can deliver that in a more modern era, as opposed to the choose your own adventure books we had way back when, doing something different. But I'll be putting finally a new story together, which I'm so excited about doing. And just like, I'm running around in circles going, yes.
Sounds exciting.
It is. So I know where you're coming from, where you're like going, I got to write the next story. But I need to have my ending.
I know.
And I'm the same way. I always need to know how it ends.
I sort of feel, I can imagine what an actor, you know, an actor feels like. If they don't have another script, you know, to.
Right.
I mean, you go, am I going to be unemployed? I mean, will I have to do the aluminum can pickup? Route?
I'm going to have to fight that guy at the garbage bin for cans. Another failed writer next to me.
Yeah, the failed writer. Yeah, it's all silly too, because you know, I know there will be another one. There will be.
Exactly.
I just love writing too much. But I'm also so insecure, and I guess people don't realize this about writers, is we just, I don't know, at some point in time, you just sit there and say, I don't know how I do this.
I sat there, it had been, it's funny because I'm in my new endeavor, I'm re-putting my books out and republishing them in a new format, and so I'm actually having to go through, and I'm reading through them, and after I'd written them, and for the first year or so after writing them, I'm like, oh, they're no good. Now that I haven't seen them in 2 years, and I'm reading snippets again, I'm like, ooh, this is good. I actually did okay.
Yeah, who wrote that?
I know. I'm like, oh, this is great. And now I'm upset with myself because I saw snippets of every chapter, so now I kind of know what's happening. It's been so long that something I come around, ooh, I forgot about that, you know, and I'm like, ah, I wish I should have just read it first and then spoil it. So yeah. I gave myself all my spoilers. I'm like, ah, now I got to wait another couple of years to read it again.
That's fabulous.
Because I always wrote for me. And I know, as you know, I always wrote the kind of book I wanted to read. And it sounds like you did the same thing too, where you go, here's what I want to do, but I'm not just writing for someone else. I'm writing for me, knowing that what I like, a lot of people are going to like.
Yes.
And you had to cut off your list of people who want to beta read for you. And when that's your fourth book after three books out, that's saying something about how you are as a writer. Because if it wasn't any good, by your fourth book, you go, I need somebody to read my book. And people are like, that's okay. But you had to cut your list off and say, okay, that's enough. So that says something about how your writing is. People want to read it, and that's great.
Yeah, no, I feel very fortunate.
Excellent. So I have asked all the questions that I had that you sent me some suggestions, and I had some others that I wrote down. Is there anything else you would like people to know about you, your series, what's next, before we shut down the interview?
Yeah, no, I again, I think the last time I mentioned, I just love readers. I hope people keep reading. And anyone watching this particular broadcast, you have to understand, Steve and I could go on for the next 4 hours talking about how unfortunate.
It's my job as host to say, okay, let's shut this puppy down. Otherwise, we'll just keep going.
And it's just so typical when you get writers together. We have so much in common. And I just, you know, as much as I love readers, I love writers too, because I would say within every writer, there is at least 15 or 16 psychological issues running around at anyone.
All anyone competing for dominance.
Yes. You can always pick out a personality, you know, of the personalities that are roaming around trying to find their way out onto the paper. So I would just ask everybody to keep reading, and I would ask, once you read something, if you like it or don't like it, write a review. It's always helpful. It's almost like sending a thank you note when you get a gift. If you look upon that book as a gift, the writer always appreciates a thank you. I know I do.
Exactly. All right. So thank you so very much, John. Don't hang up just yet. I will come right back to you. And thank you once again for letting us shine the spotlight on you and your wonderful, wonderful work. I love thrillers.
Well, thank you. And I'm always glad to talk to you and so happy to be here.
Excellent. And hopefully we'll hear from you again when some other books are out.
I hope so.
All right. So that was John. His hands are shaking like mine. So that was John, who we have here, the three books that he brought to us today. We have My Girl, His Revenge, and Our Justice. And so once again, definitely check out those books. Right now, My Girl right here is 99 cents on Amazon. So there's no reason not to go check it out. And once you start it, you're going to be sucked into the John J. Cannon universe, and you're just going to want to keep reading and you want to see how it all ends finally in Our Justice. So you have three books right there you can read, and boom, back to back, because they are all out and all out now. I highly recommend them. Go check them out. Start with My Girl, and you'll not want to stop. So once again, I'm Steve DeWinter with Fiction Silicon Valley, and this has been a spotlight where we spotlighted a wonderful thriller author, John W. Howell. And thank you very much, and pay attention to his advice. Keep reading. All right, thank